One of my favorite things in audio is the idea of immersing a listener in a hyper-realistic experience. Transporting them to a different place and time. I've been fascinated by this idea since my sophomore year of college, when my Audio 2000 professor played us an audio recording called Virtual Barbershop. The clip was made using a binaural microphone, which mimics the physical attributes of the human head and ears to replicate the localization cues that allow us to identify sound sources in space. I remember closing my eyes to listen to that recording and being so immersed that, although I knew in the back of my mind that it was just an illusion, I was somewhat surprised to open my eyes again and find myself still sitting in class. You can find the full version of Virtual Barbershop on YouTube, but here's a small clip so you can get a sense for how powerful this technology really is.
And we have two microphones, one on either side of the head, in the same position as where your left and your right ears are.
In this video, we're diving deeper into binaural recording and the physical attributes that allow us as humans to interpret the world around us through sound. And stick around, because I'm going to set up a demonstration that gives you the opportunity to experience this for yourself. By the way, I want to thank Audio University members for making this video possible without a sponsor. And I want to offer you one of the many resources available to our members, the Audio University exam. It's a fun way to test your audio skills and learn in the process. You can take the exam now for free with the link below or by visiting audiouniversityonline.com/exam. First, let's put our ears through a test to see if we can correctly identify the origin of sounds in a blind test. Then we can deconstruct the elements that allow us to localize sounds as humans. To allow you to experience this alongside me, we're going to set up this binaural microphone. In order for this to work, it's important that you wear headphones. So go ahead and put on your headphones and we can begin. I'm going to play you a series of sounds and I want you to note which direction the sound is coming from. Write down how many of those you got correct, and at the end, I'll ask you to leave a comment with your results. But first, there are a few more tests we need to run. One of the key features of a typical human auditory system and a binaural microphone that allow for such precise localization is the fact that there are two ears. This has a few implications, and the first I want to explore is a phenomenon called interaural level differences, or ILDs, the idea that a sound coming from one side will be louder in one ear than the other. If I cover one ear, I'm not going to be as successful in a localization test as I am with two ears. And the same goes for you if I mute one channel of the binaural microphone. On the other hand, if we place a pair of cardioid microphones in an XY configuration, and we pan one mic to the left and one mic to the right, it will improve your ability to localize sound from left to right because a sound from the right will be louder in the right mic than in the left mic. This is the principle behind a basic panning knob on a mixer or DAW. Turning the pan knob to the left makes the sound louder in the left speaker relative to the right speaker. Another feature of a typical human auditory system and a binaural microphone has to do with not only having two ears, but specifically having two ears that are separated in space. Having ears on the sides of our heads means that a sound from one side will reach the ear on the close side before reaching the ear on the far side. This is called an interaural time difference, or ITD, closely related to an interaural phase difference, IPD. When we pair the time difference and the level difference together, our ability to localize sounds in space is enhanced. Rather than using a coincident pair like XY, where the mics occupy the same point in space, we can use a near coincident pair, like ORTF, which introduces a spacing between the mics, taking advantage of both ILDs and ITDs. You can replicate this in a mix by panning two copies of the same sound left and right, then delaying one side. This is called the Haas effect. But be careful here, because if you sum the left and right signals together into mono, it could cause very severe phase interference and comb filtering. As you heard in the previous examples, simply utilizing a pair of microphones in XY, Bloomline, ORTF, or one of the many other stereo microphone configurations, we can provide very immersive results for a listener. But there's a reason that binaural microphones sound even more convincing. Binaural microphones not only capture ILDs, interaural level differences, and ITDs, interaural time differences, but they also capture the HRTF, or head-related transfer function. HRTF might sound like a complicated term, but here's a simple way of understanding what it is. According to Google, a transfer function is a mathematical representation of how a system transforms an input signal into an output signal. I find it easiest to understand transfer functions by looking at the transfer function of a simple EQ or filter. The transfer function of a high-pass filter might look like this, and the transfer function of a Bell EQ cut might look like this. It describes the difference between what goes into the EQ and what comes out of the EQ, and a head-related transfer function describes the effect that the head and ears have on sounds from various directions. The head shadows sounds, altering the frequency balance of sounds between the left and right ear. In addition to this, the outer ears, particularly the pinna, interact with sounds differently depending on the angle of incidence. These effects allow us to localize sounds not only on the horizontal plane, but also vertically, and that's the final feature that sets binaural microphones apart from standard stereo techniques. I want you to take the test again. This time, I'm going to distort the impacts of the pinna with Play-Doh, a technique I learned from a video on Mark Rober's YouTube channel. Write down your results for this test and leave a comment below this video letting us know how you did compared to the first test. In recent years, various tools have been released that allow us to integrate HRTF effects into a mix, as well as the other cues we've talked about so far in this video. Using these tools, the mixing engineer can pan tracks or objects in a 3D space, and the tool will process a binaural rendering of the sound that can be listened to on headphones. I personally think this is going to be the future of audio because all it requires of the end listener is a pair of headphones. But there are a few challenges that audio developers will need to overcome before that's a reality. For one, the results are best when the processor can compensate for the unique frequency response of the headphones being used. This is why we often see proprietary mixing and monitoring tools that are meant to be used with specific headphones, such as Sony VME for select Sony headphones and Neumann Rime for use with select Neumann headphones. The second obstacle is determining which system the user is listening to so that the correct mix can be delivered without inconveniencing the consumer. Addressing this problem is one of the primary promises of object-based adaptive protocols like Dolby Atmos and Sony 360 Reality. These systems would ideally identify the system a listener is using and deliver the appropriate mix, i.e. stereo for a stereo setup, immersive for an immersive speaker setup, and binaural for headphones. However, in my opinion, this promise is yet to be fulfilled in a way that is convenient enough to be used properly on a large scale with casual listeners. The final problem I want to mention has to do with the HRTF profile itself. Your ears are shaped differently than my ears, and the ears on a binaural microphone have their own unique shape as well. Over the course of our lives, our brains learn to localize sounds based on our very unique HRTF, which might be subtly or drastically different from the generic HRTFs used in the various binaural renderers and binaural panners. That's why you may not have scored as well in the virtual binaural microphone test that you took earlier in the video, compared to how you might have scored if you took the test in person with your own outer ears. Generic HRTFs tend to work well for some, and not so well for others. Sony currently has the most compelling solution to this problem that I've seen, called VME, Virtual Mixing Environment, which includes measuring an individual's custom HRTF in a well-treated space by running a series of test signals through speakers spaced throughout the room, capturing the transfer functions via tiny microphones inside the individual's ears, and creating a custom HRTF that the individual can use on their own machine to take that virtual space with them anywhere. This obviously has some limitations when it comes to accessibility and scale, but it does provide the most promisingly consistent experience that I've heard. Don't forget to take the Audio University exam, and if you're brave enough, leave your results in the comments below. If you love audio, consider becoming an Audio University member for personalized coaching, exclusive courses, and the support of our community. In the next video that's on your screen now, we'll go deeper into the topic of making mixes more realistic and immersive. I'll see you there.